Hey guys, Andrew here with Dad Verb. So when your baby's around that 6 month range, a little bit more mobile, you're probably gonna start looking into baby-proofing your home. Now I'm gonna take this by layers because it's really easy to buy all sorts of locks and covers and gates only to end up confining your kids. And some parents wanna maintain that freedom of movement and the ability to explore, but in a safe space rather than like putting up a bunch of roadblocks. So that's where we're gonna start, just answering that question of, you know, what do you actually need to stay safe but not restrictive? And then after that, we'll get into some other baby proofing items if that's the route you wanna go. So the first thing you're gonna need is gonna be electrical covers. Now this isn't groundbreaking, right? These are cheap, they're simple, you see them a lot and you can get them anywhere really. I'll link the ones that we use below, but the obvious importance of this is just gonna be to stop infants from jamming stuff in there and potentially electrocuting themselves. Many outlets today actually have some sort of childproofing built in, and I would actually prefer that over the covers, mostly because you don't have to wrestle it off. Sometimes it can be hard to get off. You might need a screwdriver or something like that. That's just a convenience thing though. Either way, that's gonna be the first thing that you're gonna be doing, and both options work just fine. Following that up, you can actually get plug covers like these to protect littles from outlets that are in active use and also stops them from pulling the plugs out. Also, cable management boxes or cord rails can limit the exposure of power strips, plugs, and cords as well. So that's definitely something to look into. And some baby monitors actually come with these, including the sponsors of this video, Nanit. Gotta give a big thanks to Nanit for continuing to support this channel. This is legit our favorite monitoring system. You've heard me say that before. We've been using it in both of our kids' rooms. If you're looking for a good, safe, awesome baby monitor, I'm telling you, this is the way to go. Got super crisp 1080p pictures, sleep insights and recommendations, and now they've got growth tracking, which is surprisingly accurate. I just tested it. You can learn more using the link below. And the next video that I have on this channel is gonna be the review of their newest release, the Nanit Pro. So stay tuned for that. All right, back to baby proofing. The second thing you're really gonna need to do is anchor that furniture, all right? Invest and good anchors according to anchorit.gov. In the United States, 469 children died from furniture, TV, and appliance tip over incidents between 2000 and 2019. No matter how much you think you have an eye on the kids, they climb on stuff. You need to anchor down your dressers, bookshelves, and your TVs. We've had some scares with IKEA furniture in particular, but everything is anchored down now. We didn't use their anchors, we actually use our own. Again, I'll link all that stuff below. Regarding TVs, if they're freestanding on like a media console or something like that, they need to be anchored to a stud. Personally, I think wall mounting your TV is kind of the way to go. Not only is it safer, but I don't know, it kind of just like looks cleaner. So if you can, buy a wall mount for that TV. So number three, I think a gate is an important addition, right? Particularly if you have stairs, obviously you want to guard infants from a fall. They're also good for fencing off fireplaces. There are different types of gates out there. There's pressure mounted, screw mounted. There's even like clip-on options. Really, there's no wrong choice here, and it's entirely dependent on kind of your floor plan and your area that you need to guard off. So you're gonna have to do some research to like figure out like what's the best option for your specific space. Our favorite though, personally for us, we've really liked retractable gates. Depending on which brand you go with, I love that they can adapt to the width of really any hallway and stair openings without the need for additional pieces like some metal gates. Our particular option, I think, ranges from like 33 all the way up to like 70 something inches, so it can block off a wide space if needed. I also like that when it's retracted, you still have that full opening to use. Some gates, they cut off the walkway pretty significantly. I will say that some retractables, you may experience some sagging at the top where the kids tug at it, but while you know it might not be as sturdy, it is still my favorite option. Now at this point, it's not only just about the baby-proofing gear, we'll talk about more in a sec, but it's also about lifestyle, so here are some other things that you might want to consider. If you have decorative items or books, you may want to move that decor up higher so your kids won't get to it. Now it's partially for their safety, but it's also so they just don't ruin it. Next, if you have plants, it's best to hang them from your ceiling or just keep them up higher on the windowsill rather than keeping them on the ground where they're easily accessible. Throw blankets and play silks, you know, they're best kept out of reach. Mobile infants could, you know, potentially wrap themselves up in them, and it may be a suffocation risk, so keep that in mind. You also want to secure dangling window cords. If you don't have a cord-free option, make sure your cords are elevated somehow. You can use something like a cord cleat to keep the ends up high. And those windows with continuous loop cords, those should be anchored either at the bottom or along the wall. It's recommended that cribs be 3 feet from windows, and if decor is mounted above the crib. It should be about 1 foot from the wall. I've mentioned it before, but nothing should be in the crib. No bumpers, blankets, or stuffed animals. Some of the very rules that I just mentioned here, I unknowingly broke in previous videos. But it's a learning experience, guys. More on crib safety down below. So moving forward, these next things I think are certainly helpful, but I don't think you need to go overboard. First are cabinet locks. Now these are gonna be great for keeping kids out of spaces where you might have like cleaning products or medicine. You can use magnetic locks, which that's what we have. There are latches and clips. Another option is gonna be like a manual press lock, which doesn't require a magnetic key. We've used many of these types. I don't really have a preference. I don't think one is necessarily better than the other. The thing that I do like though are locks that give you the option to engage and disengage the lock so that, you know, if you no longer need it, you can disengage it. And if you need it again down the line, you plan on more kids, you need to baby-proof again, you can re-engage it and get that lock back on there. One tip is to keep a few cabinets unlocked. There might be some things like your Tupperware cabinet or, you know, your place for like wooden cooking utensils or something like that. Consider keeping those open. That way they're not completely shut off from everything in the kitchen. They're gonna make a mess, but it's not like a horrific liquid mess or anything like that. It's nothing dangerous. It's a little annoying, but it's just, you know, you just put things back to where they came from, and you'll be surprised because over time, because they know what's in so many of your cabinets, they'll just stop opening them, and you won't even have to baby-proof them anymore. They'll just kind of go about their business and find other things to mess with. If you need to, a door lock might come in handy. For us, our pantry door, it didn't come with a lock, so we installed one. We don't have it engaged all the time. But we do sometimes when he's just in there making too much of a mess, even though it's safe in there, you don't wanna clean that up all the time. So we'll lock that door on occasion and just kind of keep him out of there. So door locks might be handy if you need them. Next, let's talk about corner and side bumpers. Obviously, these bumpers are great if you have like coffee tables or side tables that might have sharper corners or edges. I'll be honest and say that we started off using these a little bit because they were helpful, but eventually we just tapered off and stopped using them. For us, and I think for a lot of other families, kids just love to mess with those corner bumpers and side bumpers a lot, and they end up pulling them off. So you're gonna have to end up like reinstalling them more often than not, and you may notice that there's like this sticky residue on there that ends up on your tables. While it is helpful, I wouldn't say it's like an absolute necessary part of baby proofing. It kind of just depends on your home and what you have. We personally never use toilet guards, but I do fully understand the desire to block that off for, you know, possible drowning risk and whatnot. I'm not saying don't buy that, but it's not something that we ever used. Turned out fine. Most appliances like ovens and fridges, they have like a lock setting to protect them from it being opened or turned on or like activating some sort of function like dispensing ice. Everyone's gonna have different instructions for that. So you might wanna Google your appliance make and model and just find the manual if you need that. I'll go ahead and stop there because I feel like it's a good enough general overview for you guys. If you want to read more into fireplaces, pools, guns, I'll have all that linked below for you so you can do a little bit more reading. Really, I don't think baby proofing is as intense or as like scary as people kind of make it out to be. They feel like they put a lot of mind to it. You just kind of have to take it a day at a time, figure out what parts you need to block off. You probably won't just do it in one day. It might be something you learn over time. But yeah, take it slow, you'll be fine. If you have any additional tips that I missed or you have cool solutions to tricky baby-proofing spots in your house, please comment those thoughts down below. Definitely want to hear them. If you found this video helpful, smash that like button down there. It looks like a thumbs up. For more videos and reviews for new parents, please consider subscribing to our YouTube channel. Thanks for watching this video and come back for the next one. God bless. Later.